didn't see there. I'm Ross McRae, and these are my two friends, Jackson Hager and Brandon Garcia. Today, we're going to be talking about the basics and complexions in the Man's Guide to Algebra 1.
Now we're going to be talking about the three different types of equations: slope, intercept, point slope, and standard form.
First, we're going to be talking about slope-intercept. Now, slope-intercept is y is equal to mx plus b. M in this case represents the slope of the equation, and b represents the y-intercept of the equation.
Okay.
And next, we're going to be talking about point-slope. So the equation for point-slope is y minus y1 is equal to mx in parentheses minus x1 close parentheses. So let's go through this equation and kind of figure out what it's about. So the y1 right here, so that y is just a y from the equation. If you keep going, the m is equal to the slope. And x1 over here is an x from the equation. So you take a set of points, and then you put the y right here, the x right here, you find the slope, and then you put it right here. And then you're able to solve the equation.
Next we're going to be talking about standard form. The equation for standard form is ax plus by is equal to c, c being any expression.
And now you may be wondering, why do these matter? How are all these intertwined? Well, slope-intercept is the main one that we use. Oftentimes, when you look at a graph, it'll say y is equal to 2x plus 5 or any other expression here. But with these equations, you can actually use them to find other equations. So with point slope, by inputting it and then doing the equation, you're able to find slope-intercept. With standard form, you are also able to find slope-intercept. All of these intertwine because you are able to find each of the other different types of equations. So if you are given an equation in point slope, not only are you able to turn it into slope-intercept, you are also able to turn it into standard form. So today, we are going to be talking about fractions. Now you may be thinking, fractions? I learned those in elementary school. Why would I need to learn them again for Algebra 1? Well, we are not just learning about fractions. We are learning about how to multiply and divide fractions. So first, we are going to be learning how to multiply fractions. So over here, we have set up 5 over 12 times 6 over 10. Now for multiplying fractions, there are two main ways to do it. One is takes a little bit more time and is a little bit more complicated, but we're going to go through that one first, and then we'll give you the more helpful and easier one. So the first thing to do is to go 5 over 6, so you multiply the numerators, which is equal to 30. Then after that, you multiply the denominators, which is 12 times 10, which would be equal to 120. Now that's fairly simple. We all know 30 over 120 is 1 over 4. However, the second way speeds this process up significantly and makes it so you don't have to multiply bigger numbers. So the first thing we are going to do is we are going to reduce. Now, how we reduce the fractions in a multiplication problem is very simple. What we do is we just take one numerator and the diagonal denominator, and if they are able to be reduced with each other, then we do. So, for example, 5 divided by 5 is equal to 1. 10 divided by 5 is equal to 2. 6 divided by 6 is equal to 1. And 12 divided by 6 is equal to 2. Now we have sufficiently reduced it. So now we just do the same process as before. So we go 1 times 1 is equal to 1, obviously. And then 2 times 2 is equal to 4. And as you can see, we get the same answer as before, but we didn't have to multiply or reduce such big numbers. Next, we are going to be learning how to divide fractions. Over here, we have set up 5 over 12 divided by 6 over 10. Now, the way to divide fractions is, first, to find the reciprocal of the number that's doing the dividing. So what you do is you flip this number. So then, it would be 10 over 6. Now, instead of dividing 5 over 12 divided by 10 over 6, you actually have to multiply because you flipped the second fraction. So instead of being dividing, it would be times 10 over 6. So. Next, you multiply like you normally would a fraction. So now we have set up 5 over 12 times 10 over 6. So now we can reduce like we learned in the last one. First things first. This is the only one we can reduce. So 10 and 12. Now 2 goes into both of those. So in this case, it would be 10 divided by 2 is equal to 5. And 12 divided by 2 is equal to 6. So now we have 5 times 5, which is equal to 25. And 6 times 6, which is equal to 36. And this is the lowest amount we can get this fraction into.
Two hours later.
First try. Okay, so here we have a very simple equation. It may look a little complicated, but once you break it down, it's pretty easy. So what we're trying to do here is get the number on one side and x on the other so that they're equal to each other. So right here, negative 4x minus 6. Now, since it's negative 4x minus 6, we have to add a negative, you know, do same change, and then it will be equal to negative 20 is equal to negative 10x. Now, negative 10x is not in its simplest form, so now we have to reduce. So, since both of these are divisible by negative 10, we divide by negative 10, to get 2 is equal to x, or x is equal to 2. And bam, that's how you solve an equation.
Now we're going to be talking about proportions. Proportions are relatively simple. All you have to do is cross-multiply these two numbers right here, and then divide it by this number right here. So 10 times 10 is 100, then 100 divided by 5 is 20. So r would equal 20. Now if we test that, 10 or 20 divided by 10 is 2, and 10 divided by 5 is also 2. So these two proportions are equal to each other.
Next, we're going to be talking about indicated variables. But first, let me show you how it's done.
So, like my friend Jackson said, indicated variables. It's very similar to solving an equation, except now it involves a lot more letters, per se. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to solve for r, and we have the equation d is equal to rt. So simply, we divide the t on both sides to get r by itself, like we did with the equation. So we have d over t is equal to r. So now that we have r by itself, we know what it's equal to, and we can flip it so that r is equal to d over t. Now we're moving on to factoring. We're going to take this quadratic equation and factor it down into two components. So we start off with the number 10 in this situation. What we do is we find two factors of 10 that when you add them together, you get the middle number. So in this situation, it's 5 and 2. Now, now we're going to look at the first number in this situation, or the first component, and that's x squared. Now, since there's no number in front of x squared, here we write x and we write x. This all makes sense in a little bit when I explain it. Now, since there's no negatives involved in the addition between these three components of the quadratic formula, you put a plus sign here and a plus sign here. Now, the way that you check that this problem is relevant to the way we factored it down is you multiply this number or this component to this component, and that is equal to x squared. Then you multiply this by this, and that is equal to 10, so that's right. Then you multiply this to this, which is equal to 2x, and then you multiply this to this, which is equal to 5x. Now when you take 2x and 5x and you add them together, that equals 7x, the number right here. So now that we've checked our factoring, we know that the quadratic formula has been factored correctly.
Now we're going to talk about parabolas. As you can see here, we have two different parabolas. There's the positive one that opens up, and the negative parabola that opens down. The vertexes are the uppermost or lowermost points, depending on if it's a positive or a negative. And the solutions are where it crosses the x-axis.
And now, we're going to be learning about inequalities and how to put them on a number line. So first things first, we need to learn how to solve the inequality. Now, solving the inequality is very simple to solving a normal equation. So what we do first is, we have to make this equal to that. So we have to get rid of this 6 here. So this is pretty easy. We just minus 18 minus 6. So then that would be negative 6x is greater to or equal to 12. So now we have to get the x down to its simplest form. So we go over here, negative 6 divided by negative 6. Now the thing with inequalities that makes it different from a normal equation is that because of this sign right here, if you are dividing by a negative, you have to flip the sign. So now it would be x is less than or equal to negative 2. So now here's how we put this on a number line. Now because this is less than or equal to negative 2, over here we write negative 2, over here we write 2. And because it has this line under it, which makes it less than or equal to, we have to fully color in the circle, like that. And now, because x is less than or equal to 2, we bring the arrow back that way.
Okay, now we're going to talk about graphing inequalities. So here we have a simple inequality. Y is greater than or equal to negative 2x, and I've graphed it right here for you. It's this line right here. Not the dotted line, it's this one. And it's pretty much like graphing a normal line when you have a simple equation. The only difference is this thing right here. So whenever you see this line, you know that the line is going to be solid. However, if you don't see the line, like in this situation, the line is going to be dotted. So we've given you an example like this right here. Now, the big, there's also this other form of using or graphing inequalities, and that's with finding the solution between two inequalities. And so we have two examples here. We've already graphed it, and it's this one, which I just said, and then y is greater than 3x. So now we have the solution. It's 0, 0, of course, but we're going to have to figure out we're going to have to shade it on this or on whichever side, because we have to figure out which side is true or not, if it's a true statement with the solution. So since 0, 0 is true on both sides and it crosses through it, we're going to have to use the points 1 and 1. So we just plug that into it. So we do 1, you know, we plug it into that, so 1, and then we plug it into this. So it's basically the same thing, except we make y1. So is y greater than or equal to negative 2x? Well, yes. So now, since we know that it's true, we shade the side that has the 1, because it's true. If it wasn't true, we'd shade the opposite side. So we'd shade this side. Now onto the other one. We're still using the same 1 solution. So we put 1 and 1. So it's basically we're changing y to 1, and it's 1 is greater than 3x. Now, is that true? No, it is not. So for this situation, we have the 1 on this side, but since it isn't true, we'd shade this side.
And next, we'll be talking about the quadratic formula. So the quadratic formula is x is equal to negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac divided by 2a. Now this is very helpful for finding the solutions of a quadratic equation. Another thing that can be used with a quadratic formula is to find if it has one solution, two solutions, or zero solutions. So, here's how you do it. You use this part of the equation right here. So, you'll just input the numbers right here. And if it is greater than zero, if the answer of this is greater than zero, it will have two solutions. If it is equal to zero, then it will have one solution. So that means the vertex is on the x-axis. But if it is less than zero, then it will have no solutions, and the vertex nor the rest of the parabola will be touching the x-axis.
Oh hey, didn't see you there. This has been the Man's Guide to Algebra 1. I hope you've enjoyed, and maybe become a little bit more manly in the process.
Standing there looking at his phone on Instagram, and he winks. Noise.